بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين إلى يوم الدين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولن ترضى عنك اليهود ولا النصارى حتى تتبع ملتهم قل إن هدى الله هو الهدى ولئن اتبعت أهواءهم بعد الذي جاءك من العلم ما لك من الله من ولي ولا نصير صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected beloved students, ulama kiram, brothers and elders in Islam, first and foremost I would like to supplicate and make dua to Allah Ta'ala to give me ikhlas in these few words. May Allah Ta'ala make it beneficial for all of us. Alhamdulillah, a lot has been already said by my seniors who stood up before me. Just add a few points, inshallah, to what they have said to enlighten us of the challenge that we are facing in the 21st century. My dear respected brothers, Allah Ta'ala has said in the Quran Kareem, وَلَنْ تَرْضَ عَنْكُمْ مِنْهُ, that she will never be happy with you, the Christians and the Jews, حَتَّى تَتَّبِعَ مِلَّتَهُمْ, until you follow their millah, their madhab, their way. Now, nobody is going to come to us and tell you, follow me. See, they're a bit more smarter than that. But because they know, you just chase them away. You tell them, are you mad? Are you insane? Do you think I can just leave my religion and follow you? I was born in a Muslim home. I was brought up. My parents are Muslim. My grandfather is Muslim. They're not going to come and just tell you, follow us directly. So they're more smarter than that. Now, what has happened is, in all the turmoil that is happening in the world, we have to analyze this. As Maulana has mentioned, we are living in the zaman of irtidad zehni and irtidad dehni. Irtidad zehni means intellectual apostasy as well as verbal apostasy. Not only intellectual, we've gone steps further now. Intellectually as well as verbal as well. Now, Allah Ta'ala is telling Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَئِنْ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ, if you have to follow them. Now, obviously, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is not going to follow. This is the hypothetically Allah is saying. Actually, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah is making khitab to him, but indirectly is making khitab to all of us. Right? Because it's not possible that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is going to follow them. Right? But Allah Ta'ala is mentioning it. وَلَئِنْ اتَّبَعْتَ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. You are making, if you are going to follow them, مِن بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ, after knowledge has come to you, then مَا لَكَ مِنَ اللَّهِ مِنْ وَلِيُّ وَلَا نَصِيرٍ. So this ayat is teaching us that there can never be muwafaqat between us and the Christians and Jews and the non-Muslims. There can't be muwafaqat. The ayat is teaching us that there's no possibility of muwafaqat, an agreement as far as deen is concerned, between the Muslimin and the Jews, Christians and the other religions. You can't. There's no possibility of muwafaqat. That's what the Quran is saying. The Quran has negated muwafaqat in this ayat. And in another ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَتَّخِذُوا الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَى أَوْلِيَاءَ. Do not make the Jews and the Christians your friends. بَعْضُهُمْ أَوْلِيَاءُ بَعْضُ. They are friends unto one another. So this side, the Quran is making nafi of muwafaqat. That side, the ayat is making nafi of muwalat, that there's no possibility of friendship. Leave alone muwafaqat. Muwafaqat to dur ki baat hai. You can't even make friendship with them. Ba'duhum awliya'u ba'd. This whole saga that happened in France, na'udhu billah, when they took up the caricatures of Nabi Pak sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I want to ask you one simple question. How many Western countries or countries in the world stood up in solidarity with Islam? How many countries in the world? Rather, these countries stood up in solidarity with the French. That's what they stood up in solidarity with them. So now for us to sit with them and say, let's have gatherings. Right? What kind of gatherings? Interfaith gatherings. So there's a riwayat in Musnad Ahmad, narrated by Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Umar bin Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says that I said to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that inna nasma'u من يهود من أحاديث يهود تعجبنا أو يعجبنا. We are listening to talks from the Jews. Nice stories they're giving us. أفترى أن نكتبها. Do you feel that we should write it down? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he tell Umar radiallahu alayhi wa sallam? He said, أَمُتَحَوِّكُونَ أَنْتُمْ كَمَا تَحَوَّكَتِ الْيَهُودُ وَالنَّصَارِ. Are you going to make taraddud? Are you going to make tahayyur? And are you going to doubt what I brought to you? And what I have brought to you is بَيْضَاءَ نَقِيَّ. What I brought to you is clear cut, is crystal clear. That's what Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Hazrat Umar radiallahu alayhi. That is a short rewrite. In Musnad Ahmad, it's a bit more lengthy. Actually, it's written there that certain scriptures and stories were said in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whereby he became angry just to listen to him. He became angry for Al-Azimah. And on top of that, he added this point which I want to make now. He said, let us say we're sitting in an interfaith gathering and somebody is reading from his book, whichever his Deva or his Bible or he's reading from, whichever book he's reading from, and you are sitting there. So either one of two things is going to happen. Either what is going to happen is that he may be saying something that's haq, but because he's reading something that you don't know about it, you're going to make nafi of it. You will reject it. Even though what he's saying is haq, you're going to reject it. That's one problem can happen. The second problem that can happen as well is that either you don't reject it, but if he's saying something that's batil, you may then accept that. You may accept the butlan, right? Because you don't know. So that's what's going to happen. That's the reason Rasulullah said that you can't even listen to the scriptures. You can't even sit in the presence if somebody is reading this. Because Islam has removed, it's the dominant religion in the world, the only religion in the world. So now if we bring Islam on the platform, one platform of other religions, what is going to happen? You're giving legitimacy to other religions. You are giving legitimacy to other religions. Now, let us make this excuse that no, the reason why we're doing it is because we have to have harmonious coexistence. Harmonious coexistence. So do we have to sit in one gathering and have an interfaith religious gathering, interfaith gatherings, to have harmonious relationships? No, you can have your harmonious relationships without the gatherings. Our Akabirin have always done that. They haven't sat down on one platform with other religions. You see? So as Maulana mentioned, so there's so much of danger in the interfaith. You know, there's one group in America, CARE. They said they were having this interfaith gathering. One of the founding members, one of the ladies, she had one Christian priest put his hand on her head, praying for her, blessing her. Now what is that? Allahu Akbar. They say this Queen Latifah from UAE, she went to Golden Temple and she went and drank from the holy water of the idol. Holy water. And she comes out and she says, I'm still a Muslim. My dear respected brothers, do we even know what is happening in the world? Allahu Akbar. So one brother came to me just to soften things up. One brother, we're all students here, alhamdulillah, all ulama are gone. We are students left, right? So let's just soften up. One brother came to me and said, Mufti Sahab, I need you to perform my nikah. I say, okay. I say, but one takaza, what's the takaza? He says, you have to perform it on the beach. He says, come to the beachfront, you must perform it on the beach. I said, what? On the beach? He says, gee, you have to come. But he said, the masjid is nearby where you stay. He says, no, I want it on the beach. I'll pay you for it also. So I told him, bhai, maaf, I won't be able to help you. You have to go to that imam in that mosque. Because tomorrow, if I go on the beach, the next fellow will come and say, Mufti Sahab, you got to put your shorts on. Next one will be in the swimming pool. Do you understand? So what are we going to do now? Where are we going to draw the line? So now where this thing starts from, right? Let's start. Let's look at this properly. Let's analyze it properly. Right, secularism. It starts from liberalism. Liberalism means to be free-minded, open-minded. Do what you want, when you want, however you want. Right? And under liberalism, and that's what the nafs wants actually. Because the nafs doesn't want hudud. The nafs doesn't want any barriers and hudud. And the Quran Sharif says, Tilka hududullah. These are the hudud of Allah Ta'ala. Now those people are telling you there's no hudud. So the nafs is going to be inclined to that direction. Right? If you want to be a Muslim, you have to stay within the parameters of the Sharia. You can't make your own hudud. Sharia has made the hudud. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now they have this here. You have the topic there. Liberalism is derived from the word, Latin word, liber, which means to be free. To be free from anything. You can do what you want, when you want, however you want. Right? Now under liberalism, they have brought secularism. Now secularism means you detaching religion from the state, from the education, from everything, from the entire system. That means you have to preach. If you want to worship, you must go in your house. You worship in your house, in the corner of your room. You mustn't bring it outside. Huh? That's why like the women in France, before when they wear the hijab, they say we may charge you. They charge them for wearing the hijab. Now if they take out the mask, they say, now we're going to charge you. So they don't know whether they're coming, or they don't know if they are going. But the whole irony of this whole thing, what I'm very sad about. Now imagine, this is what they've done, right? They cannot harm the religion of Islam, right? But out of all the Muslims in the world, these organizations, Muslim organizations, what did they say? They say that, no, we stand by the French government. The Grand Mosque of Paris, the Grand Mosque of Lyon, Reunion, Comores Islands, they took out a statement saying, we stand with our government. Allahu Akbar. Your government is supporting caricatures of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you saying we stand with the government? Have we lost our mind? So now what has happened is, they have taken out deen from education. That's why it's called secular. Secular means no deen. Now a child who is impressionable from a household where there's no deen, household where the people are not practicing deen, they are not being pardoned on their salah, they don't even do five times salah, they don't go masjid, they go masjid five, once a month, stuff like that, once a week, they go in the masjid. You take that impressionable mind, you put him in a mahol and an environment where deen has been cut off. Now every day he goes there, further away he's been taken from deen and Islam. Every day he's moving further away, one step every day, one step every day, one step every day. Now can you imagine by the time he reaches university what happens to him? Now in 1859, Darwin took out one theory. And the theory of Darwin, everybody knows, the theory of natural selection. Natural selection means evolution. Give me the fancy word, evolution, natural selection. He took out the theory saying that no, everybody believes that all this that is here on this planet created by God, by Allah Ta'ala, right? So there has to be, and he's controlling it, there has to be an alternate understanding to that. So he says, no, there's no such a thing as that. Na'udhu billah min zalik. So in 1859, this is the theory, he took out Darwin. And unfortunately, right, that concept was accepted by majority of the Western countries. And also some Muslim countries also have it in their syllabus as well. Right. Now, I'm explaining this very important. You must listen to this. He says that now once the theory of Darwin has come in, that there's no such a thing. So we're making nafi of the khaliqiyat of Allah. Making nafi of Allah. Ta'ala being fatiru samawati wal ard. Badi'u samawati wal ard. Lahu ma fi samawati wa ma fi al ard. We're making nafi of all of that. Right. Now Darwin's theory, they put it, and that became the founding principle of all modern science in the world. All modern science is based on Darwin's theory. That is why most of the scientists in the world today are all atheists. Why are they atheists? Because they don't believe in the divine control of Allah Ta'ala. They don't believe in ghaib. And the Quran Sharif says, yu'minuna bil ghaib. You have to believe in the unseen. And until the scientist doesn't see with his own eyes, he won't believe. He's got to do many tests and recurring tests, and then all those samples has to come out. Then when he's 103% satisfied, then only he says, now this is what I believe in. So now, if that student is going through that, he's living, we want our science to say very important. Yes, it's very important, mashallah. But what's happening? When the student comes out in the end, what is coming out with? We have one doctor, I won't say which area. One day I made salam to him. He never answered the salam. So I asked the people, brothers, what's happening? He said, no, we're murtad. The doctor has become murtad. And now I heard that his son too became murtad. Dr. Saab became murtad. Never answered my salam. Allahu Akbar. It broke my heart. Broke my heart. Right? Now, this person will come out from the university. Now, you must remember how clever these people are. In Islam, if you make, you don't have to make nafi of the entire Sharia to be murtad. You don't have to make nafi of the entire Sharia. In Islam, you make nafi of one masala. You make tanqeed and istihza of one mustahab. If you say one thing is not right in Islam, one aspect of it, you are not happy with. There's poke in your heart. A person is kharij and iman. He's kafir. Now people may be going for hajj, he's performing his salat, he's doing this, he's doing that, he's doing everything. But he's made nafi of one masala. Allahu Akbar. Hazrat Mawlana Masulla rahmatullahi alayhi told us that there was one Mawlana, he wasn't happy with one masala. What was the masala he wasn't happy with? He says, after janaba, I don't like this. How nice the Christians. They don't have to make ghusl. So when they dug up, he exhumed whatever, they had to dig up the qabr, they never found his body there. They found another Christian, another French woman. She was buried in that qabr because she brought iman quietly. And his body was transferred somewhere else. So you don't have to make nafi of the entire Sharia. On the WhatsApp groups, what is coming out? One person says, I can't go to Jannah without tutu. Na'udhubillah. Now are you, Allah says that the requisite for going into Jannah is iman. You saying, I can't go into Jannah without tutu. Are you making nafi of all those ayat of Allah Ta'ala? My dear respected brothers, this Islam, modernism has come into Islam, right? Modernism is how it started. It started from people like a person called Muhammad Abdu, and is a person by the name of Rafa' al-Tahtawi. These people, they were so overwhelmed with Western civilization and the advancement of Western civilization that they started translating about 2,000 books into Arabic. And they started questioning things regarding Islam. They say, no, why they like this? Because independence of thought and independence of opinion and independence of mind. Allahu Akbar. And this person, he says, no, polygamy is an outdated concept, medieval concept. So in 1995, the Egyptian court, Sharia courts, they pass a fatwa that is murtad. Now, we all have to become doctors. We all have to become all these things here, right? It is a requirement, right? But we also need to understand what is coming with it. What is happening to our iman? That's also we need to understand. Allah has been taken out from the syllabus. We need to put Allah back in the syllabus. We need to strengthen our aqidah at home. We need to create the correct environment in our homes. So when our children go out, they're not gobbled up. We can't promote Western education if our iman is going to be lost. We can't send our girls to university if all the laws of Allah, of hijab, are being broken. We can't use the excuse of zarura. This excuse is being used in the wrong context. My dear respected brothers, what is happening on the ground is making us cry and sad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the other speakers after me, Hazrat Maulana has come with me, much more senior than me. I make dua to Allah. Allah ta'ala, accept this gathering. Allah save our iman. Allah ta'ala, use us. See, there's two things I heard from our akabir, Maulana Brasa rahmatullahi alayhi, and my seniors I've heard. See, one, as an alim, your job is to make proper tarjumani of Quran and Sunnah. Proper tarjumani of Quran and Sunnah. Convey, be the medium of the Quran and Sunnah to everybody. That's our job, number one. And the second thing is, look after the pristinity of the Sharia. You must look after the pristinity of the Sharia. That's also one of the compulsions of an alim. When the deen is being collapsed and attacked from all sides, we can't let it go. We have to stand up and protect the deen. We don't come first, Sharia comes first. We don't come first, the Quran comes first, the Sunnah comes first, the Ahkam of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those things what come first. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept these viewers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this gathering a blessing, so that for all in our akabirin that are present, Hazrat Maulana has invited me, Hazrat Maulana Abdul Hamid sahab, may Allah ta'ala bless him, and all our akabirin keep their saya over us for a very, very long time. And may we take correct ilm, correct knowledge, correct taqwa, and go up in the world and don't be consumed by all this year. What we have is invaluable. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.